for the 30 volunteers at Porthcawl, as for many around the UK and Ireland, their fellow volunteers become more than just shipmates.
When you go into the situations that we go into, you come to get to know people very, very well. It's just a family. That's the only way you can describe it.
Does anybody want the one with or without the hair?
We're a close bunch of guys. We deal with issues inside and outside of the station, whether it be personal, family or lifeboat matters. We are there for each other.
It's more than just boats and call-outs and exercises. We're a huge family.
Quite quickly, you become very well gelled, which is actually really special in a way that I don't think I've ever had with any other group of people. Just knowing that in some situations my life will be in someone else's hands when they're holding on to the back of my life jacket kind of thing.
Spoon, have you found your chicken tikka dry, mate? It's gone out on the table.
As a helm, you're responsible for the lives of your crew as well as your own. You feel protective. They have family at home. We know the family history. As a helm, you make sure that, you know, you're bringing the boat back, you're bringing the crew back.
When you're trying to lift him over the D-class, that wave game lifted the D-class up and you were like that.
We've all got different backgrounds, different jobs. It's not easy sometimes, but I know that if I get on that boat, they've got my back.
Spread across 238 stations around the UK and Ireland, there are 408 lifeboats ready to launch at a moment's notice. From the manoeuvrable inshore D-class to the latest £2.2 million all-weather Shannon, 10 different classes of boat all have their own unique life-saving capabilities. But the odd one out in the family isn't a boat at all. There are four rescue hovercraft stationed around the UK. In areas where tidal mudflats or sand mean the surface is too soft for vehicles and the water too shallow for more conventional craft. Nowhere is the terrain better suited to the hovercraft than here on the north coast of Norfolk, at Hunstanton.
The tide can probably go out half a mile to a mile and you get a lot of exposed sandbars and mud flats and marshes and areas like that, and obviously you can't get a boat there because there's no water. So the hovercraft is perfectly suited to be able to fly in, land there and help.
It's a unique craft and especially handy when people get stuck on sandbanks and stuff like that. We can drive straight up to them instead of the boat having to go and beach on the sandbank and then walk across to them.
I was very sceptical at the start of the hovercraft. To me, it wasn't normal being able to float from land to sea and sea to land. Over the years, probably about half and half of jobs done by the boat and the hovercraft, so, yeah, it's proved its worth.
The hovercraft at Hunstanton, also known as the Hunstanton Flyer, demonstrated its value 4 years ago, when the crew were called out on a job they still talk about today.
The initial report we had was three people cut off by the tide on Sculpthead Island. We've been there hundreds of times over the years. It was just a run-of-the-mill shout.
8 miles east of Hunstanton lies Sculpthead Island. Despite its name, at low tide it's possible to walk across mudflats to the four-mile expanse of sand dunes. It only truly becomes an island as the tide rises.
There's a wreck which a lot of people go out at low water to have a look at and then get caught that side of the channel. So we just assumed that they were on the other side on the sandbank.
But after they launched, the Coast Guard radios with an urgent update.
The next report we had was that the people had tried to swim and were clinging to a buoy. Literally, like changing gear on a bike, the situation changed immediately.
Three sisters, a 20-year-old and 12-year-old twins, were trying to wade across the deep, fast-flowing channel between Sculpthead and the mainland. Out of their depth and caught by the current, they've been left clinging for their lives to a buoy.
Now these people hanging on the buoy, and the water is ripping past them. The but it takes some strength to hang on. So we knew we had to be there quickly. If not, once they let go of that buoy, then, you know, they'd be under the water and gone.
With a top speed of 30 knots, the flyer takes just over 25 minutes to get the crew on the scene. But as they arrive, two of the sisters lose their grip on the buoy.
From having one group of casualties, shall we say, all of a sudden we've got two. Two are being swept down the tide quite rapidly. And one's still clinging to the buoy. And we don't know how long she's going to cling for.
With all three girls in immediate danger, the crew have to act fast. Michael jumps in to get the 12-year-old clinging to the buoy. The others try and pick up the other twin and her 20-year-old sister. The crew pull Molly, the first 12-year-old twin, on board.
When I was clinging onto the buoy, I felt like I was just going to die. It kept going in my head, I'm going to die, this is my last time. Zoe's our older sister, so she was sort of trying to protect us, but she was just so weak that she just lost her grip. So I could either hold back onto the buoy and lose Zoe, or just let go. So I let go of the buoy, and then just was holding Zoe up. Well, I was just sort of carrying us away from the buoy and Daisy. It was, like, pummeling us, and it was bruising us and hurting us. I just thought, this is it. We're done.
Zoe and Molly's twin, Daisy, are still in the water.
My sister! Daisy! My sister! My sister!
I was just sort of screaming at this time, saying, Daisy, she's still over there. She's still over there. Me and Daisy have sort of always been a unit, been together, Molly and Daisy, Daisy and Molly.
Daisy! Daisy! Daisy!
It was such a scary thought, thinking that one of us could live and one of us could die.
Daisy! Daisy!
The crew finally get 20-year-old Zoe on board the hovercraft. The two sisters safe in the lifeboat have no idea if Daisy managed to hold on to the buoy, or if Michael, swimming against the current, has been able to reach her.
Got close enough, grabbed the girl's hand, she let go, and sort of clung herself onto me.
I remember kind of grabbing hold of him, and it just felt amazing because I knew that at that point that I was going to make it. Another crew member reached out with hand and he pulled me up, and then Molly was already on there, and so it was another wave of relief that she was okay too.
Well, I did sort of a big relief because I was so shattered after trying to swim against the tide. But yeah, I was very, very glad to be picked up.
All three sisters are safe on board. Even just a few seconds later, it could have been a very different outcome.
I was just pure joy that they were safe and they was with me. And I wasn't the only survivor. My sisters were all together. I felt safe and happy in their presence. If the RNLI had got there later, definitely me and Zoe would have died. Daisy may have managed a bit longer, but me and Zoe, without an aid in the current any longer, I think we'd have been gone.
You're tired. How long have you been hanging on then?
Oh, well, I don't know, but it might not have been that long, but it seemed like forever. Oh.